I suppose it's fair to say, in my sister's account, I have no career risk. She isn't going to fire me.
Ever since legendary investor Jeremy Grantham told WealthTrack how he kept his sister's money safe during the financial crisis, I have wondered, what about all the other women, many of them divorced, widowed, or lifelong singles, who don't have Jeremy Grantham to call upon? Well, we've started a new feature on WealthTrack's website called WealthTrack Women. On a regular basis, investment pros who specialize in advising female clients will answer questions vital to the financial health of women. Look for it on WealthTrack.com. This week on WealthTrack, multitasking Gregg Fisher, one of Barron's top 100 financial advisors and a four-star fund manager, explains why he is fishing overseas for bargains, dabbling in global real estate, and doing tax planning. Gerstein Fisher's Gregg Fisher is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalyn P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Talk to just about any CEO of an American corporation and they will tell you their first responsibility is to the shareholders, who are the true owners of the company. And one of their top, if not the top priority, is to maximize shareholder value. Well, not everyone agrees with that sentiment, but that's a topic we will tackle another day. Major U.S. corporations take that mission very seriously. According to a recent article in Bloomberg, companies in the Standard & Poor's 500 Index, the who's who of corporate America, are poised to spend about $915 billion on share buybacks and dividends this year. That's about 95% of their earnings. And money returned to stockholders in the form of dividends and buybacks actually exceeded profits in the first quarter of this year and probably did so in the third quarter. Those policies have paid off for shareholders. According to Bloomberg, stocks with the most buybacks have gained more than 300% since the March 2009 bottom, far exceeding the very strong returns of the overall market. And the pressure is increasing to continue those and other stock price boosting policies. Activist hedge funds have amassed war chests of more than $111 billion to invest in companies and pressure them to act. For many reasons, the U.S. stock market has been one of the strongest performers in the world since the financial crisis. But many question whether its days of market leadership are numbered. And this week's guest is one of those, starting to look in battered down international markets, but he is also constantly adjusting his own and his clients' portfolios as conditions change. He is Gregg Fisher, founder and chief investment officer of the independent investment management and advisory firm Gerstein Fisher, which he launched in 1993 and now has over $3 billion under management. He's been named one of Barron's top 100 financial advisors, among other distinctions. In 2009, he also established the Gerstein Fisher Research Center, which does research on finance and investment risk with noted academics. In addition, he is the portfolio manager of the four-star rated Gerstein Fisher Multifactor Growth Equity Fund, which he launched in 2010. It is in the top quartile of its large growth category for the last 3 years. In a wide-ranging interview, I asked Fisher what he is telling clients about valuations in the U.S. market.
So a lot of clients are asking us, you know, what's going on in the market. We've just seen something like 10,000 points on the Dow in the last five or so years. You know, is it a good time to invest? Should we trim down the winnings? You know, what should we do?
And?
Yeah. And, you know, that's the bazillion dollar question, right? I do think that investors should be mindful of the fact that we've seen a major move in the U.S. equity market particularly. But when you're in a diversified portfolio, you've got to answer that question in a bigger way. You've got to look around the globe. And what we've seen actually is that the growth that we've had here in the US market has been significant, but we haven't seen that kind of growth over the last 5 years in other parts of the world. You know, we've had the European crisis, we had the emerging market challenges. And when you look at things like price to book ratios, price to earnings ratios, price to anything ratios, the rest of the world looks a bit more attractive than the US does from a valuation point of view. So I don't think it's a good idea for investors to get out of the stock market. But what they might want to do is take a fresh look at where their exposures are and perhaps consider trimming down their US holdings and adding more exposure to the foreign markets.
Even if they're early in the foreign markets, we've just had lengthy discussions with Nancy Lazar at Cornerstone Macro, and who's a very well thought of macro research firm. And their point of view basically is that there are huge headwinds in Europe, there are huge headwinds in China, and therefore that the fundamental picture doesn't make those stock markets attractive. From our perspective and valuations, maybe they are, but as far as what's going to really appreciate, their feeling is that this is the time to be more US-centric. Your response?
Well, I think most Americans have this home bias, right
anyhow.
So, any move in this direction, I think, would be good. I would take a different view. I would say that most people do feel that way, that in fact, there are these major headwinds in the foreign markets. And because of the sunlight being shined on those risks, is it possible that those risks are being priced? And that the return that an investor would receive from this point in time could be better than it would be from a period where it seemed like everything was wonderful. On the issue of home bias, most investors typically have 70-80% of their portfolios in the US markets in some form. And if you add to that their business interests, their home, most investors have probably 90% of their wealth in the US, in the dollar. I think it makes sense to just have some money in other countries, regardless of all of this, to diversify currency, diversify across the globe.
And so some money, what would you say, 10%, 20%? Obviously, if you own large cap multinationals, you've got a lot of foreign exposure there anyhow.
Well, I'll answer. There's sort of two questions there I'd think about. First is, right now, when you look at the world, by market capitalization, the US is about 50% of the world. The rest of the world's the other 50%.
Right.
So if you were totally market neutral, you'd be roughly 50% US, 50% not US. But then you're going to pick up a bunch of volatility because of currency and some other things. So, perhaps an investor consider having 30% in the foreign markets. It's less than the world market cap, so you're underweight foreign markets, but you still have exposure. So that's something that I think we should start by thinking about as to, here's the world equity allocation. May I have some position relative to that? But again, I think in terms of taking this position that markets are overvalued or undervalued, it's to take the position that the market's got the price wrong. So I think for most investors, they should stay invested in the equity markets, but perhaps it's time to consider reducing your exposure to the US a little bit. This point about the big US companies doing business overseas gives you foreign exposure. It is relevant, but actually, if you want foreign exposure, you're better off owning companies that are in those countries, who prepare their financial statements in those countries, whose most of their revenues are in those countries. And the way to do that would actually to be buying smaller companies that are doing less business across the globe. From a portfolio point of view, the reason why that's important is smaller companies across two different countries have a lower correlation with one another than larger companies.
Mm-hmm.
Across countries. So if you want to have foreign exposure, and that's a choice you're making within your portfolio, I would say buy smaller companies in each country, and that will add more value to your portfolio from a diversification point of view than these large conglomerates that are all doing business with one another.
Let's talk about what you're doing. You wear a couple of hats. You're the chief investment officer of Gerstein Fisher, but you're also the lead portfolio manager on three different funds. They're called multi-factor funds. You've got multi-factor growth equity fund, multi-factor global real estate securities fund, and global factor international growth equity fund. What does multi-factor mean, for starters?
The way we see the world is that there are multiple factors that drive the returns of markets and portfolios. So our funds, the multi-factor equity funds, embrace these principles that markets may be reasonably efficient, doing a good job of pricing risk, and that investors are rewarded for taking these risks, these multiple sources of risk. Now, on the other hand, there are often risks that investors are not paid for taking, and these are those idiosyncratic, business-specific risks we all talk about. So our portfolios are baskets of large quantities of securities. Each of our funds have somewhere between 100 and 300 securities in them. Our goal is not to necessarily outperform markets through security selection, but instead to outperform markets through these risk exposures. An example of this might be something such as small companies. We've all seen the research that over long periods of time, small companies have outperformed large companies.
Yes.
Now, some would argue that's because of risk. Others would argue it's because of behavior. Our view is whether it's the behavioral thought or the efficient market thought or risk, we don't really care what it is. The fact is it's been happening.
So accept the reality.
Exactly. The average investor is going to be the market portfolio, and that's not a bad place to be. But if you're an investor who's willing to be different than the average through these sources of risk, and you believe that risk and return are related, well then over time we should be able to outperform the flat market using a multiple factor approach.
Therefore, according to research, so small caps is one area that, you know, no matter what the reason is, that it outperforms over time. Another area in investing is value stocks have outperformed growth stocks over time. You've recently written a report called The Growth and Value Pendulum in the Markets. Explain what your findings are in between those dynamics.
You know, if an investor took their money and put 100% of it in small company value stocks and locked it away for 50 years and held it for 50 years and woke up 50 years later, probably they would do pretty well, and probably they'd do better than most other things they could do, and certainly that have been the case. The problem is, I don't know anyone who's ever done that, including the academics who've created these theories. No one does that. Most investors are human. We live real lives. We can't stand 80% swings in our money from time to time. So instead, we diversify. Now, I would argue that 100% value is 100% wrong. The average
because
the average investor experience is going to influence a large percentage of their return over time.
So this is where your behavioral finance analysis comes in.
Yeah, this is where behavior meets efficient markets. You can imagine that, you know, or you could believe that value stocks do better than growth. You could believe that small companies do better than large. But if you're a human being, you're probably not going to put your money into these things that work over 50-year periods of time. One academic that I know who's well known about these concepts and theories suggested to me once that when it comes to investing, 5-year periods of time is like white noise. And then I said to that academic, said, well, then you've probably never sat across the table from a real person before. Most of us don't have 5 years. We don't think in those terms. As investors, we should. At any rate, behavioral finance does get incorporated into this. But there is another point, which is that there are many periods where growth does better than value. And a portfolio of growth and value, based on our research, would outperform a portfolio of value only for many reasons.
How do I apply that in real life with real clients sitting across the table from me? What is the kind of a portfolio that you would advise we invest in?
What an investor could consider doing is having a little more value, maybe 60, 70% value, based on this idea that over time, value may do better than growth. But you'd still also have growth in your portfolio at maybe 30 to 40% of the total allocation. And then what's important is that since these things move differently from one another over periods of time, is that from time to time, you rebalance these things back to those target weightings.
How often?
We think in terms of percentage deviation. So maybe you would say, if at any point in time, either one of those things was off by more than maybe 5% from where we started, you'd bring them back.
That sounds like a very reasonable approach. As far as looking at the multi-factor portfolios that you run, we had talked earlier about international exposure. What's the strategy in the multi-factor international growth equity fund right now?
So imagine thinking that a small country should potentially earn a greater rate of return than a large country. So, like, for example, the United States can probably get away with borrowing at a lower rate than perhaps some other countries, Or particularly right now, most of Europe looks a little more challenging perhaps than the United States does. So the rate of return that I would demand from a company in Europe right now as an investor would be higher than the rate of return I might demand from a similar company in the US. So whether it's companies or countries, we apply this size exposure. So one of the ways we do that is, rather than using a market capitalization weighted strategy at the country level, we actually don't allow any one country to become more than 12% of our portfolio. So big countries like Japan or the UK may end up being underweight in our strategy, versus smaller countries might end up being overweight. And the idea is not that we're timing what country to be in, we just don't want any one country to be too large a percentage of the portfolio, and we want to have more exposure to the riskier small countries and less exposure to what the markets perceive to be the safer, stronger, bigger countries.
Therefore, if I'm looking at your international growth equity fund, which countries am I seeing that have the largest overweights relative to what their market capitalization is, for instance?
You're going to see a lot of parts of Europe, you know, whether it be Spain, Italy, things like that.
Peripheral parts.
Because, you know, if you think about it, if we had a 20% country like Japan or the UK, and we brought that down to 10 or 12%, well, the excess is going to be spread across the remaining smaller countries based on their remaining market cap weights. So you end up overweighting the small countries and underweighting the large countries.
Another one of your portfolios is the Global Real Estate Security Fund, again, multi-factor. We had had a conversation well over a year ago about international REITs. What is your view now of international REITs, real estate investment trusts?
Well, the idea around investing in global real estate as it relates to investors' portfolios, what we went ahead and we looked at the market capitalization of REITs all over the world and divide that by the market capitalization of equities all over the world, and you have about a 2% allocation. In other words, on average, investors have about 2% of their portfolios in REITs.
Now, globally.
I mean, it's tiny.
Right.
But real estate is significant. We don't know exactly what it's worth, but we think it's worth something like $30 trillion. So the potential for the public markets within real estate to continue to develop and grow, we think are significant.
And as far as your REIT holdings, where are you seeing the greatest opportunity right now in international, in global REITs?
Well, our portfolio is global, so we are about 50% in the U.S., and that's actually done quite well.
And as far as the valuations in the U.S. and the real estate investment trusts, what's your view?
I mean, many people would feel the valuations are very high.
And because they're income-producing.
They're income-producing. People are
and that's where everyone went. Right.
That's right. And people are concerned about, you know, discount rates and what if interest rates rise. People assume that if interest rates rise, REITs go down. Actually, we've done research on that, and it isn't that clear. There have been plenty of periods where rates rise and REITs go up, been plenty of periods where rates rise and REITs go down. And actually, if you're concerned about rates rising, you might look at your equity portfolios because they react very similarly. It's really ambiguous as to what happens with rates and REITs. But if you're concerned about interest rates rising in the U.S., that gets to your question about global investing. Our position is you might as well diversify across multiple inflation regimes, multiple interest rate environments. So by diversifying across yield curves, you can reduce this inflation risk. It may not be the case that just because rates rise in the U.S., that same change would occur in other countries. So our view is to not necessarily find whether you should be investing in Hong Kong, which I know is a little interesting right now, and or parts of Europe, but instead have a diversified portfolio across all countries. Have a diversified basket of real estate in your portfolio and do it in a way that's sensible. Picking what particular country to be invested in, we think would be a mistake.
If REITs are basically 2% of total market cap, what percentage would you say that we should have exposure to portfolio? 5%, 10%?
Yeah, I think somewhere in the neighborhood of 4 to 10%, depending on investors.
And where are you now in that range?
At about 5%. Mm-hmm. And if an investor can choose, if you're going to own REITs and you have the luxury of choosing, should I own them in a retirement account or should I own them in a taxable account? All else equal, I'd put them in a retirement account because of their tax issues. So you have a high expected return asset that over a long period of time should be able to keep up with inflation. that adds a correlation benefit to your portfolio. And from our perspective, that makes sense. Add that to the idea that if you ask a typical investor, hey, how much money do you have in real estate outside of the United States?
Zero.
The answer is probably zero.
Yes.
So if you put 2, 3, 4% of your portfolio in global REITs, and you divide that by your net worth, which probably includes your business or your home, so maybe the average investor goes from 0 to 1 or 2%. My grandmother told me when I was a kid, too much of anything is no good. But a sprinkling of real estate securities in a global environment like the one we're in our view, makes perfect sense.
Tax rates. We are in a tax environment now where taxes have gone up significantly for middle and upper income Americans. What are the tax strategies that you're advising this year?
Well, you know, I think taxes are such a critical factor in returns. We think of them as another factor. Just a point of fact, if you went back to 1976, and you bought an index fund. I won't mention which one, but imagine buying an index fund in 1976 and holding it through today. That would arguably be one of the most tax-efficient things you could have ever done. And over that period of time, the investor in that strategy would have given up about 1.5 percentage points per year in taxes. And if you do the math, 1.5% over almost 40 years, it's about a 45% reduction in market value due to this 1.5% drag. So I find it shocking when investors don't pay attention to taxes. It's so important. Anyway, some of the things to consider when it comes to tax planning. Well, for those folks that are doing things like charitable contributions, we've just gone through a period where your U.S. stocks have probably done really well up until maybe recently, but U.S. stocks have done very, very well. You might want to consider gifting some of your appreciated stocks to the charities that you have an interest in. You could think about direct gifts to charity. You could think about donor-advised funds. Lots of ways to give to charity.
And the reason is because you don't get taxed on a sale. Number one, if you donate it to charity, you also get the tax deduction, right?
That's right. You're avoiding the tax on the capital gain had you sold it. And also, you're, in addition to that, getting the charitable deduction. And that's an easy one to consider for those that are making charitable contributions. Now, from a portfolio perspective, you might want to look through your portfolio. In a diversified portfolio, no matter how hard you try, something you own is probably down. And if that's the case, you might want to consider selling some of those things and taking tax losses. However, you also want to be very thoughtful about replacing them immediately with something that you believe has similar risk and return characteristics, but satisfies the IRS wash sale rules. So to be able to do this, you have to take the position that if you own investment A and you sell it at a loss and you replace it with investment B, you have to believe that B and A are equivalent, but they have to be different enough so that you can take the tax loss without the IRS suggesting that you're not allowed to. Because if you buy back the same security, you're not allowed to take the loss. So sell investment A, buy investment B, take a tax loss. That tax loss can offset the capital gains that you may have in your portfolio throughout this year. But to the extent you have no capital gains, you can take those tax losses, bank them on your tax return, and carry them forward into future years. Investors can also take $3,000 per year of those losses and use them to offset ordinary income, which for an average person is going to save them about $1,000 in taxes. Now, in investing, we know there's never a free lunch, but that's about as close as you can get. Actually, in our view, adding value through careful tax management is often easier than adding value through picking good stocks or hiring good money managers. And as a money manager myself, I'm happy to share that.
Gregg, one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, what should we all own some of?
I would say global real estate. And I answer in that way because it's the thing that I find most investors just don't own. So most investors already are covering most styles and asset classes, stocks and bonds, growth and value, international, domestic. In some form, they've probably got a lot of that. But just based on the data, we find that very few investors own real estate securities globally, and that would be the one thing I believe people should have in their portfolio because it's most different from what they probably already own.
We will end it there. Gregg Fisher, Gerstein Fisher, thank you so much for joining us on WealthTrack.
Thank you very much.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is a response to Gregg Fisher's question, how much money do you have in real estate outside of the U.S.? Well, since most of us would say none, this week's action point seeks to change that. It is consider buying an international real estate investment trust or REIT. It is certainly an asset class that would add diversity to most of our portfolios, and real estate is desired and valued around the world. One of Morningstar's favorites in the REIT category is the Vanguard Global XUS Real Estate ETF, which it describes as offering the most diversified, lowest cost exposure to real estate securities from 35 countries around the world. Morningstar adds it is the only international real estate ETF to also include emerging market stocks, which does make it more volatile than domestic REITs. International real estate, it's worth a look. Next week, we're going to have that discussion I mentioned in my opening remarks. We are going to look at the state of corporate values. Should maximizing shareholder returns be the number one priority of corporate America? It was not always the case. Financial historian Richard Silla and award-winning financial journalist Paul Steiger will weigh in. For more of this week's interview with Gregg Fisher, go to our website, WealthTrack.com, and click on our extra feature. And while you're there, please visit our WealthTrack Women's section, where we have financial advice specifically for women from our panel of award-winning women financial advisors. Have a great weekend, and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation.